grass. If there is one plant that has come to dominate our world, it's this. Occupying every biome on Earth except the ice sheets, grasses have colonized every patch of soil, from tropical to temperate forests, savanna to steppe, scrubland to desert. Humans have taken these grasses and shaped them over generations into crops that feed the world today. Their homelands are the seeds of grass we call meadow, prairie, pampas, veldt and steppe. The world's grasslands. Grasslands are one of only two biomes on our planet to be completely dominated by a single class of plant. But what is grass? A simple definition is a non-woody plant containing a hollow stem for strength, bladed leaves for photosynthesis, and a flowering bundled seed head for reproduction. This simple but highly successful formula has evolved since the end of the Cretaceous period, about 66 million years ago, to form over 12,000 species today, and grass's ability to colonize poor soils, survive fire, and turf out competing plants has allowed them to spread to almost every corner of Earth. The prairies and steppes are the biomes where this class of plant is fully dominant. This is in comparison to the savannas of the tropics, so often confused with grasslands where we find a mix of grasses, shrubs, and trees. Grassland areas occur in relatively temperate, drier climates, either in the mid-latitudes or in high-altitude regions such as the Himalayas and Andes, where rainfall is insufficient for tree growth or where historical conditions such as pervasive fire or large animal grazing have prevented trees from gaining a foothold. There is no one crop and climate type that matches global grassland distribution, with continental and cool semi-arid zones along with humid and highland subtropical zones and even oceanic areas having grasslands. This indicates that the coupling between grassland and climate is not as strong as in the other biomes so far looked at, with major coppin groups B, C and D being represented here. If we consult our Holdridge Lifezones chart, we can find the grasslands in the center as steppe, where conditions are neither particularly cold or hot, but where overall rainfall is on the drier side, indicating that grasslands can dominate in these more arid areas where trees might struggle. So you've probably heard the terms prairie and steppe, and possibly pampas and veldt too. These terms are more regional in usage than technical. Prairie is almost exclusively used to refer to the grasslands of North America, and is a word borrowed from the early French settlers to this region, meaning simply meadow in that language. Steppe refers mostly to the grasslands of Eurasia and is taken directly from the Russian word for this biome. Pampas is the most common word for the extensive grasslands of mid-southern South America, and is from the Quechua word for plain. Veldt, the Afrikaans word for field, is a loose term used to describe the open upland country of eastern South Africa that is sometimes grassland but might also be scrub. Beyond the vernacular terms, grasslands vary more technically in the height of grass, and in the absence of grazing animals, this relationship is determined by the amount of rainfall and soil drainage. Where the soil is wetter, the grasses will grow taller, with some species growing up to 4 meters in height, while more arid conditions lead to shorter grass. Anyone who has tried to dig up the turf or sod of their lawn will know how well grasses bind to the soil, and the tall grass species also follow this pattern, with roots burrowing into the earth as deep as their structures are above ground. As grasses are flowering plants, meadows burst into vivid color during the season of plant reproduction, which occurs in the spring in the mid-latitudes and at the beginning of the wet season in subtropical highland areas. So where in the world do we find the grasslands? The two northern continents of North America and Eurasia form most of the land area of this biome, with the great plains of their heartlands being made up of prairie and steppe. The southern hemisphere, by comparison, has more isolated areas. The North American prairies extend unbroken, in vast plains from Alberta, Saskatchewan and Manitoba in Canada, south and east into the central part of the United States, including the states of Montana, the Dakotas, Minnesota, Wyoming, Nebraska, Iowa, Kansas, Missouri, Oklahoma, New Mexico, and Texas. In these regions, the eastern parts receive more rain and are naturally tall grass prairies, which blend into the temperate forests of the eastern part of that continent. As we travel west toward the Rockies, Less rainfall leads to shorter grass until semi-arid and scrub conditions occur. Parts of the high desert of Washington, Oregon, Idaho, and Nevada have grassland, as does the low-lying Central Valley of California. In practically all these areas, however, the excellent soils and suitability for wheat and corn farming have led to the decimation of natural prairie, with very few areas remaining. South America has three areas of grassland. The first, known as Puna, can be found in upland subtropical areas of the Andes, where much of this remains preserved in its natural state. It's a different story for the pampas of northeastern Argentina, Uruguay, and southern Brazil, however, where the extensive pampas has been converted almost entirely to farming, with ranching dominating. Lastly, the eastern tip of this continent, from Tierra del Fuego to southern Patagonia, as well as the Falkland Islands, are dominated by grasslands in the most polar latitudes of any in the world. In Africa, that continent dominated by the tropical savanna, only a small portion of it in eastern South Africa is considered a part of the true grassland biome, found in uplands where it is known as the Veldt. We find a surprising area of natural grassland on both islands of New Zealand, a country otherwise dominated by temperate forests owing to its oceanic climate. The causes of these tussock grasslands are poor soils in the centre of North Island and a rain shadow in the South Island, east of the Southern Alps, that reduces rainfall significantly. In the Middle East, we have relatively isolated pockets of grassland in upland areas of Turkey and the Southern Caucasus, while mainly subtropical areas surrounding the Tibetan Plateau have this biome in a similar way to those of the Andes. However, these areas pale in comparison to the largest area of grassland on Earth, the vast steppe plains of Eurasia. Running in an unbroken line at around 45 degrees north in latitude, the steppe separates the temperate and boreal forests of the north from the deserts of the south. Starting in the west of the continent in eastern Europe, they encompass the whole of Ukraine and southern half of European Russia, where most of the natural steppe has been transformed into the wheat belt that feeds these countries in a similar way to that of the North American prairies. Further east, the steppe runs along the boundary of Russia and Kazakhstan, and then east again, ending with the border of Mongolia, where the northern half of that country is dominated by steppe still mostly in its natural state. Species diversity in natural grasslands is high. Region by region, we find in the North American prairie, among others, big bluestem, Indian grass, and switchgrass species. In the Eurasian steppe, common species families include stipa, festuca, and agropyron. The eponymous pampas grass is found in that South American grassland, while the equally eponymous veldt grass is from South Africa. And in the New Zealand tussock grasslands, chionocloa is common. Like the savannas of Africa, the presence of large areas of edible grass in the prairies and steppes have resulted in the support of vast herds of grazing animals. In North America, there were once tens of millions of bison roaming the prairie before the mass slaughter of the 1800s. And let's not forget that the grasslands of North America and Eurasia led to the evolution of perhaps the most important animal in human history, the horse. As mentioned, most of these areas of natural grassland have vanished, being replaced by agriculture, such as the quality of their soils and climatic suitability for cereal crops. But unlike other biomes that have been diminished by human activity, the grasslands have really just been adjusted, because what has replaced these grasslands is just more grass. The domestication of various species of the grass family into cereal crops is regarded as one of the key developments of human civilization. Wheat, corn, rice, barley, oats, millet, sugar, and many more crops that directly or through fodder for livestock feed us are all grasses. And so this humble family of plants that colonized the world and later went on to feed ours can be thought of in many ways as the most important in our world. And that is the grasslands. I hope you enjoyed this foray into these green seas. If you did, please like and share this video and let me know your thoughts in the comments. Don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss future episodes, and thanks again for watching. I'll see you in the next part of this series when, for many of you and myself, we'll be coming home to the forests of the temperate latitudes.